outside the door of love and mercy. You wonder if there's a place there for you. You know there's peace inside, but still you're searching for someone who understands the pain you've been through. Well, the Spirit waits with open arms. It's calling out your name. Come on in, welcome home. You are loved. Spirit, God's waited so long for your homecoming day. He knows the peace you need and the hurt you're feeling. He wants to hold you and wipe your tears away. Well, the door's unlocked, the lights are on.
Good morning, and happy Mother's Day to those of you who are. I especially have a pocket square because my mother likes it. And so I promised her that as long as we would be doing this and she could watch online, that I would sport a pocket square. So happy Mother's Day to all. My name's John McLean, and it's the privilege of a lifetime that I get to be the minister here at Unity of Nashville, a wonderful church. Yeah, that's been here for over, I feel like I've been here for over 105 years. But that can't be true. That can't be true. And I did take a tally, and I am the 21st spiritual leader of this church. I'm number 21, so maybe I should get a jersey that says 21 on it before I go. But it's been a noble work here for such a long time, doing a great, important, and unique work in Middle Tennessee, and I'm very grateful to be a part of it. If this is your first time here, because you happen to be online, we're very happy that you're joining us today. We love to share our experience with other people. And for those of you that have been here for oh so many decades or days, that I trust that there will be a word, an idea, a lyric, an image that will occur to you today that you will feel is just for you. Somehow, that's the way it always seems to work. So welcome one and welcome all. We are a praying ministry, and we have a prayer that I affirm every night at 9 o'clock in the tradition of Charles and Myrtle Fillmore. And upon rising, And this week's prayer is in your e-hymnal for those of you who are at home. And if you have one here, let's affirm this all together, shall we now? In the infinity of life where I am, all is perfect, whole, and complete. I willingly release all that is not true, helpful, or kind, thus allowing great expansion of my soul. And with trust and thanks, together the people said, Amen. And now let us know how we can pray with you. You know, if you will send us a prayer request in the chat bar there for those who are at home. We are honored to take those requests into my prayer circle on Wednesdays. And then we, of course, send them on to Silent Unity as well. For those of you that are here in the church, you can do that as well through your iPhone, as long as you have it on silent. And please let us know how we can pray with you. I'm going to turn around. I'm not turning my back to you, but I want to talk to them. It is so nice to be back up here with you. And boys, I miss you on the way back. I'm sorry. But I'm looking at you. I'm looking at you. And we're changing things every week. We want to get it exactly right because this is something that's going to be happening for the rest of our natural lives. We're going to be doing two forms of worship simultaneously. So we're going to be spending the next couple of weeks fine-tuning our visual presentations, which leads me to announcements. The most upsetting announcement to me is that of the trillions of cicadas that are coming to visit the East Coast, we're not getting any here in Davidson County. I am so bummed out. I thought maybe they'll be good for pizza topping. Maybe they'll be good for croutons. Who knows? Ooh, that's nasty on Sunday morning. We're not getting any cicadas here. I'm really upset about that. It's brood 10, and we're brood 11, so that happens in 3 years. But we're not getting them. I was excited about it. Okay. This week's sponsor, as every week's sponsor, is the 12 Powers. And this live stream in particular is brought to you by the power of renunciation, your divine capacity to say no to the untrue, to the undesirable. And in doing so, it expands the possibility of goodness in your life. Your 12 powers are all aspects of your soul, and they are there to be mindfully drawn upon in the face of any challenge. They will bless you. Our annual business meeting is not next Sunday, but it is the Sunday after. Did anybody get a packet in the mail yet? No. Okay. You will get them probably on Monday with a lot of material in it. So here's the drill for the folks here and people at home. If you get a packet, that means you are registered as an active member. Our bylaws say that the trustees have to be elected by secret ballot. That means if you're watching online, most of us will be watching the annual meeting online, Facebook Live. You can't vote yes or no in the chat bar because then it's not a secret because your name is attached to it. So everybody has to return an absentee ballot which has been sent to you and it is already stamped. So complete your ballot. Do not put your name on it, on the ballot itself. And then mail it in as soon as you get it, all right? One of these details, perhaps it's a bylaw we could change. Yes, and the other thing is that May is the month for the 100 Thing Challenge. We're not that excited about it here. Yay! Okay, so here's the deal with the 100 Thing Challenge. It goes along with the power of renunciation. Stuff you're not using, get rid of it! You create, that's good, that's fine. That's fine, you have a mask on. You're okay to woohoo. Along with the power of renunciation, we willingly release all that is not helpful, which is stuff that you're not using. So here's the deal about the 100 Thing Challenge. I did this week because I always like to do it the week before. And I'm good at this because I've been doing it for 20 years. So I got 87 things out of the house, and that took me 35 minutes. The secret is start in your medicine cabinet. I found a prescription that had expired in 2002. That means I've moved with it four times. So that was half of the stuff. Bring clothes to the Goodwill. There are people that need them. That'll get you your 100 things right off the top. Can it be anything? Glad you asked. It can be anything. Get everything back into recirculation, creating a void so that something good and something new can come into your life. I promise it's fun and it's exciting. What doesn't count? What doesn't count are wire hangers. Like if you have 400 wire hangers, that counts as one thing. Wooden hangers count as one thing, but wire hangers only count as wood thing. And the other thing that doesn't count are these plastic cutlery things, because you know you all have 700 of these because you've been having food delivered all year long, right? And you go, oh, I might need these sometime. No, you don't need them. Get rid of them. But however many you have, that only counts as one. So the 100 Thing Challenge, do it. You got a week. No fooling around. Get rid of it. I also released 114 books. Ouch. That was hard. And I deleted, think about this, I only know this because I emptied my trash and the computer, and then I filled it up with files. And it did take me a long time, but I deleted 738 files from my computer. Yeah, we got a lot of stuff hanging around. So go through this process, release as much as you can, making way for something new and something to be grateful for. And so let's have our gratitude practice, yes? I will be saying this for the rest of my work life. For those of you that continue to stay in the flow of your gratitude practice and support this unique and important ministry, I personally thank you, but I also say good for you. You get it. And that is probably the nicest surprise that most ministers have had in this country, is that the number of people across all denominations that continued to support their church home. I thank you for doing that. And I know that you don't do it out of any sense of obligation, but that you get it, that this is important, and as you give, you receive. That is the law of this planet that we live on. So I will thank you for that. And for those who have experienced financial loss during this time of quarantine, make sure you somehow continue to pay forward the good that's in your life so you are still part of giving and receiving. And now let's sing together, shall we?
Flow, Spirit, flow through me as I open up to be an expression of your unfolding peace. Show, Spirit, show through me as I open up to be an expression of your unfolding love.
To the God beyond our imagination or our understanding, nevertheless, we give thanks for all that is a part of our lives, for loving relationships, for beautiful weather when it comes, and even for the rain as it gives us life. There is so much to continually be aware of and be grateful for and open up to the miracle that life truly is. Thank you so much. And so it is, and amen.
this world learns to live as one. Oh, better times will come. Soon when this world learns to live as one. Oh, better times will come.
Indeed, huh? Better times? You ready for it? Yeah. Thumbs up. Thumbs up at home? Thumbs up. Yes. Two thumbs up. And one of my questions would be, then how are you going to know them when you see them? So you're going to feel it, yes. And we have to create those better times. That's the work that we do. We have to be about the business right now of knowing what that's going to be and finding out a way for us to be the primary creative force behind that. And if we don't, things will go, what, back to normal, which is not acceptable. It's not acceptable. But whatever it is we choose to create together and individually, what we choose to create together and individually, we will realize in retrospect that this will have been a profound component of our next life, of our next best thing. Not the second best thing, but the next best iteration of your life and my life in our life. And no doubt we will all also realize, as we're about that business of creating this next best thing, that this experience will have strengthened us and focused our energies in ways that otherwise wouldn't happen. I want to be sensitive to the moment, to the experience of those who have experienced great loss during this time. Yet for those of us who are survivors and are planning on what the next 5, 10, 40, 60 years might be, because sometimes I think I have a godson who's just 13 who will be living to the year 2100. You know, and if I don't assume responsibility right now for imagining what that world is going to, you know, we're all creating by what we're thinking about right now. But as I said, no doubt we will realize that this will have had a very important, powerful, and formative impact, I hope and pray, on our vision of a better world, of better times that will come. Looking back on this time when we'll tell the stories of it, and we will tell stories about this time, maybe for the rest of our lives, we will realize how important it was. And as I was thinking about this, a poem was brought to my attention, which I had never heard before. But it was from a very traditional, not a first-generation Unity writer, but a second-generation Unity writer. And her name was Martha Smock. And she wrote a poem called No Other Way. And I've already put this on our live stream Facebook, on the Unity of Nashville Facebook page. So if you want to refer back to it, you can. It's on the Facebook page. No other way. Could we but see the pattern of our days, we should discern how devious were the ways by which we came to this, the present time. this place in life. And we should see the climb of our soul has made up through the years. We should forget the hurts, the wanderings, the fears, the wastelands of our lives, and know that we could come no other way or grow into our good without these steps our feet found hard to take, our faith found hard to meet. The road of life winds on, and we, like travelers, go from turn to turn until we come to know the truth. That's great stuff. That's important stuff. We should forget the hurts, the wanderings, and the fears, the wastelands of our lives. Well, that's a spiritual practice. I don't know that I can forget them all. And frankly, I don't know if I want to forget the challenges or the sadnesses that I've experienced, because they have helped form me and helped shape me to who I am now. But in reviewing them, know that there was no other path I could have possibly taken in my life that would have gotten me here to this place today. And it is a place that is very satisfying and very rewarding, and not without continued challenges, which I, as a practice, hope to always see as opportunities. That sounds mindlessly cheerful, I know. But there comes a point in your life when, if I'm going to assume, I won't say you, that's impertinent of me, if I'm going to assume responsibility for my life, I really have to respond by saying, what do I do with this situation now? This is an opening somehow for me. You know, we have a tricky aspect of consciousness, which is called your ego, and that is not your enemy. It is your friend, but it is a harsh friend, and it's a very demanding friend, and it needs to be told who the boss is of your life, and it is not the boss of you. At some point, everyone needs to put their hands on their hips like a four-year-old and say, you are not the boss of me. Your ego is not the boss of you. Once you realize what its function is, and its function is to keep your body safe. The ego's function is to, this is an art history expression, the ego's function is to conserve and or restore that which always has been, because it thinks that's safe and comfortable. It's about conservation and restoration. It is not about creating anything new or rewarding. It is not about adventure. It is not about exploration. It's about a willingness to tolerate that which is. When there is something else in us that is always calling us forward into a larger expression. I happen to be taking a class right now as a student, and that was yesterday afternoon. It's a once a month thing. And we were talking, the lesson was about Moses and the Israelites, and we're several weeks past Passover at this point. And you know, for the telling of the story that we know either through the book or the movies, Moses was lucky because he had a burning bush to get his attention and tell him what to do. And, you know, that doesn't usually happen for us. It's not that dramatic. It's not that theatrical, nor is it that colorful, where we get somebody else who clearly is a person of authority who's telling us exactly what the right thing to do and what has to happen now, and you better do this, or else. It's the burning bush that sent Moses on the great adventure back to Egypt to free the Israelites. And in that context, the Israelites are known as enslaved people. Now, archaeology has given us some very disappointing news. They never were there. But let's not have the facts ruin a good story at this point. It is in the Jewish tradition, it is said that only 10% of the people, the enslaved Israelites, left Egypt. The movie and the superficial reading of the text would have us feel otherwise, that everyone said, oh, yippee, let's go on an adventure into the unknown. But only 10% of the people said, sure, I'll do something new and scary and risky. Most of us follow the advice of ego and say, no, even as bad as my life is right now, I'll put up with it. Very few of us make a great leap into an adventure and into an unknown. But you know, here's the thing that's so either pathetic or entertaining. Hard to know. If we but stop and look around and become aware of the astonishing life around us and the opportunities that are all around us all the time, we would know that in reality there probably isn't anything to be afraid of. Why would you sit in a situation and learn to tolerate it because I'm already used to it? The spiritual adventure is one of, and you know, the story of Moses and the Israelites is the unfolding of the spiritual adventure. The whole thing is to become more and more aware of the miracles that are around us, and in realizing that that's what normal is, the miraculous is normal life on this planet, be free. Be free to live on a risky edge. Be free to be willing to take advantage of opportunities when they come. I remember as a young person, I took some chances which were not career smart, but in retrospect, they were thrilling, interesting, adventurous, mind-expanding, and life-enhancing. And as I look at myself at this moment, I think, you know, like this poem says, that I could come no other way, no other way. If I hadn't taken those chances, if I hadn't experienced the losses that I'd experienced, and there were some pretty expensive losses, but no other way would I have come to this moment where I feel I am more aware of the good that's around me, the creative power that's within me, and that in reality, every day, it's gravy. This is all gravy. the skillful one, I suppose. Might consider forgiveness as a key component of their own personal growth strategy. Because as the poet writes here, the hurts, the wanderings, the fears, the wastelands, it's not easy to forget. But we must forgive them. We must forgive them and say, that happened, and I'm not saying it's okay. That happened, it's over. And that experience is not going to hold me back from taking more chances and being open and available to more life. At this time, I especially think of younger people, some of whom are here and support us in the creation of this experience that we call our church. And my prayer for them is that as scary and impactful as this time has been, and it's not remotely over yet, that I hope it doesn't dampen their enthusiasm or their willingness to take risks. I hope that it's kind of a thing that we all can embrace and say, you know, life happens. And if I have the privilege of carrying on, I am going to do so with more gusto than I have ever done in my life, because I have learned at a young age that tomorrow is not guaranteed. And no other way would any of us feel that unless we've had some of these experiences. Yes? You know, there is a kind of a silly and simple expression of it, it's all good, which was so popular for so long. But, you know, to mindfully think about that is important. If you gotta call it something, and we seem to have to call it something, that's the way the brain works, call it good. Call it something that I learned from. Call it something that has been formative and creative for me. Call it being any hurt, wandering, fear, or wasteland, call it an experience who will make me so much better, so much more compassionate, so much stronger, and so much more available for whatever that promised land ahead of me might be. Yes? Let's conclude with a moment of silence, shall we? So I will invite you to put anything aside that might be in your hands or on your heart. And know this. Know this about your life. That as an aspect of our own conscious, growing conscious awareness, if we could but see the pattern of our days, we should discern how devious were the ways by which we came to this present time, this place in life. And we should see the climb our soul has made through the years. We should forget the hurts, the wanderings, the fears, the wastelands of our lives, and know that we could come no other way or grow into our good without these steps our feet found hard to take our faith found hard to meet. The road of life winds on, and we, like travelers, go from turn to turn until we know the truth. Having made turn after turn after turn, I can tell you my experience has been, even when accompanied by ill health, loss, or death, it is still true that all is well and life is good, and we are truly blessed. And let's hold that in our hearts for ourselves and for all whom we care about for a moment together in the silence now. Knowing that life itself is abundance, that nature is not only abundant but profligate in its givingness of self, season after season, year after year, millennia after millennia. The life principle abides in its fullness on this planet and within each and every one of us. And knowing that takes me right to the edge of knowing no fear. For life is an ongoingness of all. Life is the self-givingness of spirit. And we, expressions of life itself. To remember that truth is to be blessed, healed, and prospered. And so it is. And amen. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for spending your time with us. I celebrate your willingness to keep your commitment to a Sabbath for yourself, for a time of soul enrichment and recreation. creation. And simply keeping a commitment is the first step in spiritual growth. So I recognize that in you, and I applaud you for that. I know fellowship happens when we encourage each other on our journey. Do that. Reach out to somebody this week. Maybe your mother, for those of us who are blessed enough to have moms who are still with us. And give them a hearty thanks, as I give my mom a hearty thanks right now, for all that has been and yet to be. And as always, in closing, you pray for me and I'll pray for you. Yes, because that's just what God's children do. And before we close today, let's know the prayer of protection, shall we? That's a beautiful service that we can provide for all who are in the shadows of life, in the front lines, at risk or near death. Let's know that the light of God surrounds them, the love of God enfolds them, the power of God protects them, and the presence of God watches over them, for wherever they are, God is, and all is well. And we'll see you again next Sunday morning.
Safely to arrive.